Hi. So my name is Abhishek, and I'll be giving this talk regarding the backer autocomplete. So basically, it's why it's called backer. We have had autocomplete before, and so we had to make it backer because the issue with the previous autocomplete was a latency, and it was very, very slow for the editors in the web browsers. So why do we need code completion at HackerRank? So it's this. So HackerRank uses web-based aggregators. These are just HTML-based aggregators like ACE and CodeMirror. So we kind of use these in the browser so that candidate and any user who is taking the test or writing the code in the browser is able to use the code completion efficiently. So basically, another point is that it makes it easier for them to use the code editor and type as fast as possible. Because HackerRank is mainly focused on the competitive programming, so you need to make sure that you type code fast and focus mainly on your algorithms instead of the syntax. And also another thing is that there is a context switching. If you switch from browser to your editor, which is on your system, so that context switching takes lots of time, and it's better to actually provide all the features that you have in your system editors on the web-based editors. And another thing is that you also need to have low latency so that it doesn't seem like that it's really slow and you are getting the completion in very, very slow time. So this is the previous solution that we had. It's first one is the Eclim. Eclim is basically Eclipse with a Vim wrapper, so that you run it over in Linux with a virtual display, and it's basically a memory. It takes lots of memory, and it's basically an overkill. So it was very, very difficult to maintain lots of Eclim servers on multiple instances. So that is an overkill, and the latency was very, very less. So another thing is that we could also have built tries, but they are not really comprehensive, which means that it takes lots of time to create the tries for your code, and making it fast, it's not feasible. And they are not really comprehensive, means that you may end up showing the completion of some other class, which is not really context sensitive of your function. And another is inbuilt keywords that are basically in your aggregators. Those are just list of some terms, but they really don't do much. So in this section, I'll tell you how does the code completion in reality works. So the main things are parser, grammar, and ASPs. So first of all, a parser is a software that actually convert your code into tokens, and you can then get ASP after that. So for getting parser to work, you need a grammar. So you need to have a grammar file for the language, and actually there are locks available on the online that you can get for all the languages, but if you really need to provide the completion for any language that you created, you need to have a grammar file. And so parsers in compilers are very, very strict in terms of when you pass the code to your parser, they will raise an error if there is something wrong with the syntax. So what we need in a code completion, because the user is actually writing the code and it's partial, it's not complete at all. So what you need is you need parser with an error recovery, and so that they can handle errors, and they can also pass the code which is incomplete and still in some mode. And obviously they should be fast enough, because if you provide the code completion of your code in let's say more than 200 milliseconds, then it's going to be very, very slow for the user on the browser side. So we really need to make sure that the completion that you get is under the 100 milliseconds so that it seems faster to the user. Okay, so this is the parser side. So as I said earlier, compiler has parsers which are strict, and they will raise the errors if there is a syntax issue, you miss a semicolon, you miss some curly braces, or you having a port like anything. So we really need parsers which can tolerate errors and give you some damn ASPs. So what you can do for that is you can actually, in terms of compiler terms, what you can do is you can move back to a state where your code is able to produce some ASKs. So that is one approach that parsers really do. And another is that you can also apply your own heuristics and general approaches to make it tolerant. For example, let's say your indentation is of your code is bad, and you can move back one step before so that your code can be parsable. And another thing is you can send this whole code which can be parsed. So it's just general algorithms that you can use. You can add comma, semicolon, replace missing braces, or remove one stack call from the function so that you can actually make that you can get the ASCII for your code. So that's the whole agenda of this this completion, that you should get an ASCII from which you can run your loop and get the completion of your code. So this is what an ASCII looks like, and on the right side you can see a JavaScript snippet which is used here, and see AD is incomplete here. So if you try to parse this using some parser which are very strict, it will raise an error that it's not really defined. And so as you can see here, AD is so this is parsed using a error tolerant parser, and you have got some ASK. Now you can loop over the code and actually get what you have to complete at this section. Okay, so what we have done for this code completion to work on our web-based aggregates. So this is the current solution that we have. We have separated all the daemons for the languages. So Eclim was used to be a single software that used to provide the completion for all the languages, but now we have moved this to separate daemons. So we have separate daemons running on the servers for Python, PHP, and other languages. And it's also modular, which means at any time in the future, if you add new languages, it can actually make it work with that. And another thing is that it also helps you to apply the tokens from the web-based aggregators to the server side so that you can create the whole file and you don't send the whole file again and again for the completion to the server. And it also helps you to maintain the project. So HackerRank has a thing called full stack aggregator, which is basically kind of full stack projects, like say AngularJS or Django. So in that you have folders and lots of files. So you really have to make sure that those are synced to the server so that you can provide the correct code completions. So this is the architecture of the code completion. So it's basically under a private net and auto-scaled, obviously for all the servers that we have. On the right side, you can see that there is a main interface that uses a main interface to provide XHR and WebSocket connections for the different parts. And there is a socket server that listens to all the requests that are coming from the browser side, which could be under the WebSocket or XHR. And then they transport those to the specific language daemons that are running on different TCP port. So here it's all the languages are running on specific port, and we handle PM2 and to basically run all these services so that we can provide, and we also have a config file that is being loaded by main interface and all the daemons so that they run on specific forking servers. All right, so this is the current language support that we have. It's lots of languages, but we plan to add more. So let's move to C and C++. How does we provide C and C++ language support? So it's basically uses C-lang, which also has an error recovery mode for the parser. And if that doesn't work for you, you can write your own as an interface, and you can get that. And it supports both C, C++, and Objective-C on the Linux. So this is the Python. This is the nice part, because here it uses JRI, which is a static analysis engine for the Python. And it also uses async server, which is running on some TCP port, so that when you get when you are asking for Python completion to this server, it pre-caches the JRI module as a Python in that async server, and you get all the completion for all the Python modules. So for example, you can just cache math module or URL lib in Python and get the completions. And this is actually running on async server. So the main interface that I showed you earlier calls that socket and get the completions for that. So this is a Java. So in open source, there is not really some, no good options available. There is Eclipse, there is some old Vim Java Complete is there, which still is very, very slow. And so all in all, in GitHub, there is no good open source Java completion thing available. So what we did is we used Java parser. It kind of parses the Java 1.7 and 1.8 and we uses that and our own implementation on top of that to make sure that our Java code runs faster and gets fast enough, and that's the whole point of this Java. Okay, so these are the languages for JavaScript, Go, and PHP. So for JavaScript, we uses Turn.js. And that inside uses Acorn parser, which is also a quite good parser with error caroling facility. And it also, so it's also very fast as compared to other, which are Uglify.js and lots of other parsers in JavaScript community. And Go, similarly, we uses Go code, which provide you documentation and the completion. And it also uses daemon ways to it also runs a daemon server so that you can get the Go completions. And PHP, actually, it's quite easy to get the completion of PHP because everything is just a function. And if you need classes, then you can just simply go with the same approach of AST, and that's it. So for PHP, we are using language server, which is the new protocol that is described by the Microsoft. And it's used in Visual Studio Code. All right, so this is the C Sharp and Swift. So we also have lots of users which are using C Sharp, and Swift is also being asked by lots of users that they also need a Swift support in the browser. So C Sharp is by Mono, and we use Omni Sharp on the top of that to get the code completion. But this is kind of slow, but still that makes it work because Omni Sharp has a HTTP wrapper that you can call to and get the completion for your code specifically. Another is SourceKitten and Swift. SourceKit is basically another language recognition for the Swift, and SourceKitten is the command line parser for the SourceKit. So you can get the command line wrapper for the SourceKit using SourceKitten. So how does these daemons communicate with the main interface of the language server? So all daemons for the languages connect to a node app, which is using WebSocket server and handling the XHR requests, and they connect via TCP sockets on all the ports that is being run for the languages. And there is a file write time, which is around 2 to 10 milliseconds, depending on the server that we use. So different type of languages uses different type of mechanism. For example, in C-Lang, you have to provide the file so that you can include the headers. So that is why we need to write the file to the disk in order to get the completion of those code. So not really all languages require the files, but few of these require, so that you should make sure that the file writes are very, very fast. And we also skip in some daemons. For example, Python doesn't really require files, so you can just send the string of the code that you have, and you can get the completion. And we avoid skipping the file writes. Okay, and the backend is connected with the editor on the browser via WebSocket, because what we do is we don't send the whole code at one time, we send tokens. So we need to make sure that every time you send a token, it doesn't end up on the different servers. when you are adding ELB or ALB in front of the servers. So we have to make sure that the connection is sticky and it ends up on the same server that is being connected to, and your patch is not really messed up if you send tokens for your code from the browser to server. So this is the project based completion. So as I said earlier, we also have an editor which is full stack. So you have lots of folders, files, configs, and what you need is you need to make sure that you only share the tokens to the server, and then you can actually provide the completion. So you can't send the whole folders and files. That is too much to send. So we use this algorithm called differential synchronization. It's basically similar to all the collaborative algorithms, but this uses the same mechanism as Git uses. It diffs the changes and it sends over the network and apply it to the, on the server side. And so it's not really similar to operational transform that we use on another editor, but it makes sure that the work is done for the project because it's fast enough for us, and when latency is not really high, it works every time. Sorry. So this is the further optimization that we did for this whole thing to work. Okay, so the packet journey of auto completion. So we had users in India and all over the world also, but the main servers were basically in US. So the whole round trip time was around 250 milliseconds to 300 milliseconds. That was too much to carry if you provide the completion in 400 milliseconds. So that counts to 700 milliseconds for the completion. And on average, if you consider the congestion head of line blocking, you will get up the completion in 1 seconds, and that is really, really slow if you are typing seamlessly on browser for the code completion. And we also use WebSocket for as I said earlier, for the tokens, and also make sure that the TCP connection is alive. And that's the latency part, because you really now need to make sure that the latency is reduced, because whatever we could do on the application level has been done. So what we have done for that is geolocation routing. It uses Amazon Route 53 based geolocation routing so that you can connect your users to the nearby local areas and get the completion as fast as possible. So this actually reduced the time from 250 milliseconds to around 30 milliseconds if you have users close enough to your servers. So this is actually the last stage of the application, because you can't optimize that much in this case unless you really optimize on the application level. So we should really focus on making sure that the geolocation is last step on your application deployment so that you can actually reduce the significant amount of latency. So this is the consumption parts of the previous autocomplete and the new autocomplete. So before we hack this, so this is one gig data of all the languages. And as you can see on the left-hand side, on the top there is Java, which has a count of around 450,000, that much. So this is one gig data, and the whole requests that are coming to servers are around 1.5. And these are the top few languages that I've shared in this graph. So on the bottom, you can see that the Java has a latency of around 400 milliseconds. And similarly, the Python has 150 milliseconds on average for all the users. And we kind of spin off 25 M4 large EC2 instances for this, which was really, really huge, because and most of the requests were getting time out because Acclim kind of just hangs up on some requests, and these were so. This is the current consumption we have. So we reduced the time from the server's count up to 5x, and now it's only 5 to 7, including the geolocation servers on different AWS zones. So you can see pretty much the request count are same, but the latency has been decreased significantly. For Java, it's around 100 and below 80 to 100, And for Python, it's around 15 milliseconds, which is a huge, huge difference from 150 milliseconds to 15. And similarly, for all the languages, JavaScript is around 10, CPP is around 50 to 60. So that is significantly less before the previous ones. Also, you can see that the languages on this right bottom, these are Go, CPP, 14, and C, which are significantly in lesser count, but still that ends up on the same daemons as those are running, because CPP and C++ has a, CPP and C has the same daemon. But still it ends up getting the lower latency. So this is just a demo that I wanted to show for the Python part of the editor. So this is written on the main prod server with the nearest location to the user. And you can see when you type, you are getting the completions at a very, very fast rate for all the index. So this is for the Python, and similarly for JavaScript, we also have this. So it doesn't send the whole code at one time, it only sends one tokens, and that is applied on the server side so that you can actually create a file and just pass through the daemons whichever you are using. Yep. So now the alternate ways. So in this whole slides, you have seen that I have what I have done. But is that the only way to actually provide the code completion? So no, but that what we done. So there are two other ways that we could have done this thing. So first is the AntLR. It's actually a language recognition tool. You pass a grammar file and it will generate the whole AS key or the tree for you. And it's written in Java. It's quite popular in Java ecosystem, and you can actually use that for all the languages, but we are not sure that if we end up in the same case as Eclipse is for this. So AntLR actually can divide your languages into multiple parts too, depending on what you want to do. And another is language server protocol. It's by Microsoft, and it's quite new, but it's used to actually provide the code completion documentation and other features to the Visual Studio Code, and it's now being finalized for the Visual Studio Code. So we could have used this, but the main issue that we handle is that language server protocol is for few source code is limited to the projects. So it's really like you are connected to one single file project, and the language server protocols, you have to pass the project folder, and then you can get the completion. So if we run on our server like this way, we will end up showing the completion of different users to some another users, because it's actually a singleton that you have to run on single folder. Okay, so these are the keynotes for this whole slide, what we have done and what we should. So the first is that we should always make sure use of concurrency as much as possible, because we use concurrency of different parts of our application. First is handling multiple WebSocket connections. And so what we do is we launch multiple node processes, and we don't end up running multiple socket as a files. So that means that we run language daemons as a port, so that you can connect to those using all the node processes instead of just creating a new socket file using same node processes. And we also use concurrency on the language daemon side. For example, in Python, it's kind of blocking. So you need to run an asynchronous server that will provide the completion for the Python code that you are getting. Another is that you have to always optimize the application first before moving to the networking part. Because that's networking part, you can actually scale up and you can launch new servers, you can either add geolocation routing, you can do TCP optimizations. So those are pretty straightforward, but at least make sure that your application runs in fast response time. And another thing that you have to consider is the factors like file write time, because for our application, we need to make sure that the file write times are fast, and if you can avoid writing file to the disk, you should do that. And another is extra hop. That means if you end up creating lots of clients and lots of socket servers on the on your servers that will transport your data from one part to another, you should avoid that too, because in that is a congestion issue if you have lots of users. And another thing is you need to make sure that you reuse your TCP connection. Either you use keep alive HTTP2 WebSocket, it doesn't matter, but at least your connection should be stable enough, and you should be able to send the data without making sure that there is another TCP connection to the server. And the another point also is there that you need to make sure that the data that you send to the server is compressed or significant. So, for example, when you can just send the tokens that you can apply on the server, you don't really need to send the whole code to the server. Which means that if you have, let's say, 100 lines of code on your web browser editor and you send that is a lot of data to send. And if you send the tokens, it will be lesser packet, lesser head of line blocking, and it will reach fast there with less number of packets, and you will get latency as less as possible. And significant data means that you don't really have to skip the data or that you really have to make sure that the data that you send is as less as possible, but it should be usable enough to create the whole file on the server side so that you can get the completion. Okay, so geolocation. Geolocation is the fact that our latency got reduced 8 times, but our the application was at least 5 times lesser. So it should be last, because then that's the last option that you have. Not really, but there are others. But still, that's the last that you can do to reduce the latency to very, very lesser time. So when you actually reduce the application load time to the to significant amount lesser, then you can actually promise on this thing that this will make things work. Also, the one point I want to tell is that the graphs that I showed was not included, that doesn't include the network latency. That is the application response time. And also, there is another thing that in code completion, you need to make sure on the browser side, you are using WebSockets. If you are using WebSockets, you need to make sure that you reconnect every time if the connection breaks, because that doesn't make sure, because if single user is typing, that will not make it sticky. So that's it. Any questions? Yep. Yeah. Sorry?
Just to repeat the question.
Do you use a RAM disk for your files?
No, we don't.
Why?
So, in file write times, all the gamins do not really need the file on the disk. So for C lang, when we could reduce the milliseconds to lesser time, for example, in our servers, it takes 2 to 10 milliseconds to write the file to the disk, right? But what we can do is we can use those daemons as a server. So what we do is we don't use clang command line, we use clang server. So that significantly reduces the time, and we don't really need to create the files. So the backer optimization is it's a micro optimization, but still, if you are not able, you need very, very less latency, you can still skip that thing. But I would suggest that you turn that language daemon into a server so that you can actually cache all the modules and the ASKs of the pre-built files. That will be a major impact on the completion. Yes.
Hi. I realize it would require a lot of dev time, but have you considered leveraging the client browser in doing all the parsing and prediction?
I'm sorry. Can you repeat?
For autocomplete, and predicting what the user might be wanting to put in next, have you considered leveraging the browser's JavaScript capabilities?
No, we haven't. Because so there are few language daemons that you can actually run on the browser side and avoid all the network and server things. But still, you have to make sure that they are comprehensive and they should be they should work on all the project-based completions too. So I also said that there is a project-based editors. So you can't really provide the completion on the client side, and there is very, very less that you can do on the client side. Instead of just creating the GIF of what you have and sending it over the network. Any questions?
Cool. Thanks very much, Abhishek.
Thank you.